As global currencies begin to plummet and as a result they become cheaper, as the world economy becomes more unstable, it's only natural that thousands of common folks have begun investing their precious money in crypto. Crypto is a highly volatile asset. It's no secret that you can lose your shirt in just a couple of hours trading crypto, but people invented stablecoin. Stablecoin.
What the hell is even that?
Stablecoin is, quite literally, a stable coin. It's when one piece of funny money is sort of equal to $1 in face value. It's kind of like the crypto dollar. And everything would be clear and transparent if the crypto dollar were printed by the Federal Reserve System like the actual crisp greenbacks. But no, not only are crypto dollars printed by who knows where and by who, there are also all sorts of currencies. This video is entirely dedicated to the most popular and shady crypto dollar on the planet, Tether USD, aka USDT. Most people are generally happy with the fact that it is indeed possible to exchange one USDT for one real US dollar now. Now we will tell you how it came to be so and what risks this obscure financial pyramid has. I remember looking at this graph a year ago and not understanding how it happened that in 2015 these tethers were nearly $1 million and in 2021 they became about 80. No, not millions, but billions. Many people wondered
where the money comes from.
It turned out that USDT is, so to speak, printed by a very specific entity, Tether International Limited, which was established in Hong Kong in 2014. And supposedly, and I stress supposedly, this entity issues one USDT for one real crisp dollar. You might also be able to contribute to this. The situation is typical. You come home after your shift, you hand over 100,000 greenbacks to some fella on the internet, you get 100,000 crypto bucks in your account in return. The reverse situation is also supposedly true. You hand over your crypto bucks and you get real crisp dollars in return. I mean, it's all clear, simple, and transparent. One USDT is backed by one real US dollar. But reality is never as pretty as the idea. In reality, Tether's backing looks like this. Short-term US Treasury bills, bank deposits and money market funds, short-term corporate bonds, other investments. Roughly, it's four categories. No question about the first one, it is the US Treasuries that many market players know about. They would turn to dust if the US were to declare default. The second category is also supposedly okay, given a disclaimer, if we know what kind of banks they are and we consider them sustainable. The third, the situation is about the same as with the second category. Who knows what kind of bonds there are? It's one thing if it's a bond of, say, Microsoft, but it's totally another thing if it's of some Chinese real estate developer. And the fourth category is literally all sorts of things. There are loans to unspecified firms, precious metals, and even digital tokens. This is the most opaque and obscure category. For a quick understanding, these four categories can be divided according to the principle of a traffic light. The first one is green, the second and third are yellow, and the fourth is red. Accordingly, there is a simple conclusion. The more green there is in backing, the safer we are. The more red, the more we feel wetting our pants. Now let's look at the proportions of crypto dollar backing. At the end of last year, it was like this. Closer to our time, the situation improves slightly, with a little less red and a little more green. Here, I expect you to ask, why are there all these different types of backing anyway? Why can't you just keep one crisp dollar on your balance sheet for every one crypto dollar? Tether, in this case, is essentially a crypto bank. At a regular bank, you and I put money on deposit at interest, and the bank already tries to lend that money out as loans at an even higher rate of return to make profits on the rate differential. In Tether, people are essentially depositing money for free, just in exchange for USDT. Tether, of course, also wants to make profits on this. 6 months ago, placing money in the safest assets such as US Treasuries or the safest bank deposits could earn them an annual return of about 0.1%. If Tether wanted to make even a little more money, it had to put its existing reserves into something with a much greater risk of losing money. Where does Tether's backing data come from anyway? Well, Tether has been publishing some, and I stress it here, some reports since 2017. It's not a full bank audit report, but very rough info with no specifics. For example, in 2017, the report looked like this. They just redacted the bank's names. The backing info itself was done by a Cayman Islands-based firm. Are these reports transparent and complete? Are they credible? No, and no. But there are no other documents for analysis in the public domain. We work with only what we have. Much more sordid details have been uncovered by the New York Prosecutor's Office, which has been trying to get to the bottom of...
Where's the money, Lebowski?
As a result of the investigation, Tether was banned from any dealings with New Yorkers and forced to pay $18.5 million in fines for numerous occasions. Firstly, Tether was straight bullshitting people, publicly stating that money was in dollars in a bank account, but in fact they were depositing it in a very diverse and non-transparent instruments. And it was the prosecutor's office that forced them to increase the level of transparency. And secondly, Tether and Bitfinex tried to hide an $850 million loss in 2019. What is Bitfinex? It's a rather large cryptocurrency exchange whose owners also run Tether International. So you could say that Tether's crypto dollar is, so to speak, printed by Bitfinex de facto. It's all so bizarre out there, to be honest. In November 2018, Tether Limited sent $625 million to the Bitfinex exchange. Why? Because Bitfinex kept $1 billion of its money in a shady Panamanian, sounds like the movies, Panamanian pseudo-bank crypto capital, which had problems with law enforcement in various countries at the time, and Bitfinex had problems accessing that billion deposited there, respectively. And the cherry on top was delivered by the very same New York prosecutor's office. Quote, "No contract or similar written agreement was ever entered into between Crypto Capital and Bitfinex or Tether." I mean, they've sent a billion there for just, like, safekeeping. Anyway, there's really a lot of digging that can be done here for the amusement of viewers. For example, we could go into the biography of Tether's chief financier, who was previously a plastic surgeon. But we are going to leave that to the debunkers and busters on the internet. Another important thing to note, exchanging Tether for dollar via Tether Limited itself directly seems to be possible. Well, why wouldn't it? That is the fundamental idea after all. But at the same time, these guys have shed all responsibility. On their website, it says,
"Tether reserves the right to delay the redemption or withdrawal of Tether tokens if such delay is necessitated by the illiquidity or unavailability or loss of any reserves held by Tether to back the Tether tokens, and Tether reserves the right to redeem Tether tokens by in-kind redemptions of securities and other assets held in the reserves."
Basically, it says, well, if we can't exchange it, we might not exchange it, who knows how it's gonna be. It's understandable since Tether's equity is tiny. The strict Basel III rules require regular banks to maintain equity capital at no less than 8% of total assets. Essentially, this means that even if something happens to these 8% of the bank and it disappears completely, the owners of the bank who risked their capital will take the hit, while those who had deposits in that bank would not be affected in any way. In the case of Tether, their equity capital, according to their own reports, is only 0.2%, which is about 40 times less than that of real banks. So, the owners of Tether do not risk much, but the holders of USDT will have problems even with a very small drop in the value of the company's reserves. Despite all the irregularities, deceptions, and skeletons in the closet, Tether has been quite successful in retaining the one-to-one rate. Yes, in the middle of the historical chart you see movements from 91 cents to $1.08, but since early 2021 the deviations are negligible. How does this retention happen? There should be one clear ability at the top of the agenda: to exchange USDT for a real dollar. It's supposed to be there. We talked about it recently, but I personally haven't tried exchanging it. Well, at least because the exchange is made in lots of $100,000. Moreover, people say that not everyone is given this opportunity, but the fact that it is given is certain. Because if Tether didn't give such an opportunity at all, it wouldn't have survived for 6 years. Nor would it have traded on the very transparent US exchange Kraken, especially directly in the Tether real dollar pairing. If one Tether starts costing 99 cents, buyers usually swoop in. It's either the lucky ones who have access to redeem the Tether, or just market speculators who are confident that the rate will level off, thus increasing demand and returning it back to $1. If demand suddenly goes through the roof and the price of Tether becomes higher than the dollar, then it's simple. A bunch of speculators will gladly sell their crypto dollars for real ones, or Tether Limited itself will print more crypto dollars and meet the demand, thus bringing the price back to $1. And the funny thing is that Tether International itself usually does not need to redeem huge amounts of tokens in exchange for real dollars all the time. Their job is to maintain a stable exchange rate, and for that it is usually enough to redeem only a small fraction of the tokens in circulation periodically, maintaining users' confidence in the system. So that you and I, ordinary sluggards, can exchange our $1,000 through peer-to-peer. Hundreds of thousands of tokens are exchanged every day for rubles, pesos, liras, dirhams, dollars, and other currencies. All that's because in the minds of most people, you can exchange that Tether for real money at any time in some exchange service. And the big players exchange millions of USDT for real dollars at Tether International itself. So there is no reason to run and redeem the crypto dollars with real dollars right now. This realization allows you to keep Tether for a week, a month, or even years. It's like we used to live with the knowledge that dollars can be exchanged for gold, but no one ran frantically to exchange crisp papers for ounces of gold, unless, of course, there was a crisis. There's a similar situation going on now. Tether's stability and transparency is much less than the dollars, after all. In this video, we talked about shady reports, about the lack of audits, about companies from the Cayman Islands. All this creates the risk of commencing a raid on the bank, only not on the bank in this case, but on Tether International. Especially when supply chains are breaking down, global inflation and at the same time recession appear, wars, global pandemics, climate change. In short, the world is a harsh, volatile and unstable place. All sorts of things can happen. For example, just recently, Tether Limited redeemed 16 billion USDT for the first time in history. Meaning someone came along and said, "Here's your 16 billion tethers, give me the real dollars." Some will say, "Good, the load is going down." Others will say, "The bubble is already bursting." In reality, we don't know the truth. It all depends on how much the backing of the stablecoin is shaken. Tether's reserves, as of the 31st of March, don't have that larger proportion of shady assets, only about 14%, which doesn't look scary at all. But since then, Tether has already redeemed more than $15 billion, or about 20% of the stablecoins in circulation. Usually these redemptions are made with the highest quality and most liquid assets. In Tether's case, that's money in bank accounts and ultra-secure US treasuries. The shadiest assets, like crypto or loans to who knows who, are likely to remain on Tether's balance sheet. Thus, if the capitalization of USDT tokens in circulation continues to fall as rapidly, the potential hole in Tether reserves could well increase from 14% to 30% or even 50% of the entire balance sheet. In this case, it will raise big questions about the backing of USDT with real dollar assets. After February the 24th, when the Russian-Ukrainian war commenced, Tether was, and still is, a great way to keep your money, both in terms of nominal value and management. Tether can still be transferred anywhere in the world, avoiding colossal fees, delays, and possible refusals. There are risks and nuances everywhere, though. Ultimately, it is always a question of your own personal financial management. Now, it's important to spell out the purpose of this video. There are two extreme points of view. On the left, we have "Our future lies with Tether, crypto for the win!" And on the right, we have "Total scam! Tomorrow this pyramid will crumble down!" I understand that the video will do well if we advocate either an extreme left or extreme right point of view. But you remember the truth is always somewhere in the middle. I'm not saying Tether is a scam, it definitely has problems with accountability and transparency, but it also has been a great tool for transferring your money for 6 years now. At the same time, one cannot blindly judge the future by the past. The world is changing, different events are happening. You have to take into account both international and local environments. And almost every few weeks, a new crypto project worth tens of billions of dollars collapses loudly. Luna UST, Celsius, Three Arrows Capital. Therefore, there will be no predictions here as to whether or not Tether will burst, much less when. What I can tell you is that it is definitely not a pyramid scheme. Simply by its definition, it does not declare any return on investment. It can be compared to a shady bank which issues its own derivatives, and banks, even the most honest ones, can also go bankrupt. For Tether International, whose integrity, thanks to the New York Prosecutor's Office investigation, is highly questionable, these risks are even higher. I personally have decided for myself this. I have used Tether and will continue to use it, but most likely only for my day-to-day needs. Another thing is that I won't keep most of my money in it. For longer-term savings, I would look at other stable coins, but then again, there are risks there too. There is no ideal option. I want to make another video with a review of the remaining stable cryptocurrencies. Write down comments if you're interested. And share this video with your mates to get them into this cryptocurrency stuff. Or the opposite, to make them steer clear of it like wildfire. And now we thank our crypto bros from Patreon. Thank you for supporting us and staying with us no matter what. Treat your finances wisely. And I'm the Researcher.